Hey robot makers, are you ready to bring your MicroPython projects to life? In today's video, we'll learn how to control motors, servos, and LEDs using GPIO pins. And by the end of this tutorial, you'll be able to build your own mini robot or automated light show. So let's dive straight in and have some fun with MicroPython. Welcome to the Raspberry Pi Pico with MicroPython GPIO Mastery course. In this video, we'll be covering the basics of using MicroPython to control GPIO pins on the Raspberry Pi Pico. To follow along with this course, you'll need a few things. First, you'll need a computer, tablet, or phone to read the course materials from. You'll also need a Raspberry Pi Pico board, some jumper wires, and a breadboard for some hands-on practice. And of course, you'll need some different components to connect to the board, such as LEDs, motors, sensors, and other electronic components. This course is divided into 16 lessons, each covering a different aspect of using MicroPython with a Raspberry Pi Pico. In the first lesson, we'll be covering the basics of MicroPython and GPIO pins. We'll look at the different types of GPIO pin on the Raspberry Pi Pico, their basic functions, and how they can be used in various applications. We'll also take a closer look at the Raspberry Pi Pico's pin numbering system and learn how to identify each pin. By the end of this lesson, you'll have a solid understanding of the basics of MicroPython, GPIO pins, and you'll be ready to start building your own projects. So are you ready to get started? Let's dive into the first lesson. First, let's understand the GPIO numbering system on the Raspberry Pi Pico. I have this poster on my wall normally, and you can see on here it has all the different markings of all the different pins. This is a really useful reference to have to hand when you're building something and you want something physical you can quickly refer to. First, let's understand the GPIO numbering system on the Raspberry Pi Pico. The board has 26 GPIO pins in total, numbering from 0 to 25. Pins 0 to 21 are available for general use, while pins 22 to 25 have additional functions. Each GPIO pin can either be configured as an input or an output. Inputs receive signals from external devices, and outputs send signals to external devices. There are four types of GPIO pin capability on the Raspberry Pi Pico: digital input, digital output, analog input, and pulse width modulation output. Digital input pins receive either a high 1 or low 0 signal, while digital output pins can send either a high or low signal. Analog input pins can measure voltages between 0 and 3.3 volts. While pulse width modulation pins can send a pulse signal to control the power supply to the external device. Not every pin has the same capability. Make sure you check the pinout diagram before you connect any pins. Now that we know the different types of GPIO pin, let's move on to configure them for use. Let's take a look at pin numbering. So there are two types of pin numbering system that we can look at. There's the GPIO pin numbering system, and that's referred to as the Broadcom. It's a Broadcom chip inside. And if we flip it over, we can also see that there is a physical numbering of the pins, starting at 1 and working our way all the way around to pin 40 at the top. So there's two different ways of referring to the pins, and this can confuse people when we're getting started. So when we write code, we tend to refer to the pins as GPIO pins rather than the physical pin. So just bear that in mind. Before we start using the GPIOs, we need to understand about the voltage levels. To measure the voltage levels of the pins, we can use a multimeter like this one here. But before we do that, let's talk about the voltage levels that you will encounter. The pins on the Raspberry Pi Pico are all 3.3 volt. There are two pins which are an exception to this, which are actually 5 volts. And these are the very top two. The first one is where the voltage comes in from the USB connector. It's exposed through that very first pin there, so that's 5 volts. The next pin down is also 5 volts. The rest of them are 3.3 volts, or ground, which we'll come to later. So it's really important that you work to the correct voltage levels, being 3.3 volts, but when you're using the Raspberry Pi Pico, otherwise it can damage your Pico's processor. So always make sure you check the datasheet of the component that you're using to make sure that it's compatible with 3.3 volts before you start using it. That's it for this lesson. Now let's have a look at digital I/O. Pins on the Raspberry Pi Pico can either be high or low. High corresponds to 3.3 volts and low corresponds to 0 volts. Now let's move on to digital input and output. Digital input means when we read a value from the pin, and digital output is when we set the value of the pin. Let's set up a simple circuit with a push button switch as an example. We'll connect the switch to one of the digital input pins on the Raspberry Pi Pico and then read the state of the switch using the MicroPython code. So I'm over here with my bench cam and you can see the code on the screen share as well. So let's have a look at this small program. So the first line, we're going to import machine. This is how we access the GPIO pins and all the machine functionality of the board. We're going to import the sleep function from the time module, just so that we can introduce a small delay when we're reading from our button. And what we're then going to do is we're going to set up the button pin as this button underscore pin variable. So we'll say equals machine.pin, and pin represents all the GPIO pins. We're then going to use GPIO pin 0, which that's the very first pin on the Pico. We're going to say that this is machine.pin.in, and that tells MicroPython that this is an input, a digital input. And then we're also going to say machine.pin.pullup, and pullup says make sure that you switch on the resistor inside the chip so that we don't have a sort of floating value. It is either a 1 or a 0, and that resistor helps us do that internally. We've then got this little loop, so this says while true, so run forever. If the button pin value equals 0, then we want to say print 0 to the terminal, and also print button is pressed. If the button value is equal to 1, and that's because we're using the pull-up resistor, then that means that the button isn't pressed, and then we're just going to sleep for a tenth of a second. So let's run this and see what happens. So it's saying 1 and button is not pressed, and you can also see on the right hand side at the bottom here we have this little graph showing that we're currently at 1 volt and nothing is being pressed. So if I now press the button, we can see button is pressed and it's dropped down to 0. I let go, we can see the button is not pressed. If I sort of alternate between the two, you can see the little dots and dashes there, like some kind of Morse code. So that's just a simple example. You can do an awful lot more. You can control LEDs, you can read sensor data, and so much more. Next, let's look at pulse width modulation. Pulse width modulation, or PWM, is a technique that allows us to control the amount of power being delivered to a component, such as an LED or motor. By adjusting the duty cycle of the signal, we can control the average power delivered to the component. So I've got a little program here I've written. It simply creates a pulse width modulation object on pin 0, which you can see is the top pin there. And we're setting the frequency to 1000. So we're also setting the duty cycle to an unsigned 16-bit integer. Don't worry about that, it's just a number, to 250. So let's run this. It's going to sleep for a second and then it's going to turn off the light. So if I hit the run button, you'll see the LED glows quite dimly at 250. Let's change that and add an extra 1 in front of that. So it's now 1250. You can see that's quite a bit brighter. Let's change that to a 2, brighter again, let's change that to a 3, even brighter. So by adjusting the pulse width, we can make the light brighter or dimmer. So let's take a look at motors and how to control them with pulse width modulation. So a motor is a device that converts electrical energy into mechanical energy. It has a rotating shaft which can be used to move objects or drive a wheel. To control the speed of the motor, we can use pulse width modulation. Now we will have to use some kind of driver board, such as this one here. These are quite common driver boards and very cheap. These are known as L298M. And they have a couple of inputs. So this one will drive two motors. You can see int 1, int 2, int 3, int 4. And on the other side, we have motor A and motor B, which have got two outputs. The reason we need these driver boards is because the Pico only has 3.3 volts and it's very low current, and motors require a lot more current and possibly more voltage. So we need some kind of driver board that will convert between the two and receive the signals. And the signals that it receives are these pulse width modulation signals. So over here on the bench, I have a Kitronics robotics board, and this enables the Pico to have the driver board, which we've just talked about, have a battery to power the motors, and they've also included some really handy classes to make the code a lot easier. So the class that they include is called Pico Robotics, and if you want to get this, you'll just have to go to their website, and there's a link there to a GitHub repository where you can download the code and then just run it and install it onto your Pico. So I only want to test one motor, so in this loop here for motor in range, you could set that to 4 and all 4 motors could be activated. I'm just going to use one motor. This Mars robot I have on the bench here just has 2 motors in it, one each side. So what it's then going to do is say motor on, motor plus 1, and then the direction and the speed. So this will make it really, really easy for us to control. And you can see there for speed in range 100, so it'll go from 0 to 100, and then it'll sleep for 10 milliseconds, and then it's going to do the same again where it'll go from 100 down to 1, so it'll go faster and then slower. So let's run this and see what happens, shall we? So I'm going to click on the run button, and I need to switch on the board, of course, first. So let me just do that. There we go. So it's going backwards and forwards. And I've got an alternative view of this as well. So we can see here, I've got some post-it notes holding that motor up there as well. And that's simply so it doesn't run away. I hope you enjoyed part one. Stay tuned for part two coming later. And I'd like to give a shout out to some of my supporters. So we have Michael and Matt, thank you so much for the coffees, and Marin and Victor as well. And then we have Marlene, we have John, Tom, Shemi, Steve Phillips as well, who are members on Buy Me a Coffee. On YouTube, we have Dale, we have Carol, we have Jose, Skipper Banks, Jeff for WPBody, Bill, we have Hans from Cheerlights, we have Michael, and we have Tom. Thank you so much for supporting the channel. So I hope you enjoyed this video, and I shall see you next time. Bye for now.